Now let's look at the second law of motion. This is the net force case. It says that force equals mass times acceleration. So what does this mean?
First off, it says that forces cause accelerations. If you push on something, it accelerates. It speeds up or slows down or it changes direction. You can also turn that around. If you see something accelerating, you know that there's a net force acting on it.
Look at the pitcher throwing a ball. He's exerting a large force on that ball so that it accelerates from stationary to a high speed. As soon as he lets go of the ball, he's no longer exerting a force on it. There's still gravity pulling it toward the ground and air resistance slowing it down, but the pitcher can no longer make it go any faster.
It also says that the more force exerted, the more an object accelerates. If the pitcher puts a large force on the ball, it accelerates more, and hence it gets up to a higher speed than if he exerts very little force. Lastly, the second law says that the more mass an object has, the less it is accelerated. If that pitcher tried to exert the same force on a bowling ball, the ball wouldn't accelerate nearly as much.
Notice that it's the ball's mass that matters, not the pitcher's. We'll worry about the mass of the pitcher when we get to the third law, but for now, we're only interested in the ball and the force the pitcher exerts on that ball. The units of force are just a combination of the units of mass and acceleration. Since we use kilograms for mass and meters per second squared for acceleration, force is just kilograms meters per second squared. We usually shorten this to just newtons. Notice what this means. If you're calculating force, you have to make sure you convert the other units to kilograms, meters, and seconds, or you won't get newtons out as an answer. Similarly, if I give you a force, it will be in newtons. Lastly, we'll often write the second law as A equals F over M. In other words, if you know how much force you exert on how big a mass, you can figure out how much something will accelerate. If you've had some algebra, you should check to see that you know how to get from F equals MA to A equals F over M. Now let's look at an example of calculating acceleration with the second law. Imagine pushing on a car with a force of 400 newtons. If we know the mass of the car, 1,000 kilograms, then how much does it accelerate? Also, how fast does it get going if we push on it for 3 seconds?
First, we need to find the acceleration. We start by writing down the formula, A equals F over M.
Then we write it down again with the values in it. So A equals 400 newtons divided by 1,000 kilograms. 400 divided by 1,000 is 0.4. A newton is a kilogram meter per second squared. If we divide that by kilograms, we'd get just meters per second squared, which is an acceleration unit. So the acceleration is 0.4 meters per second squared.
Does this make sense? A car is a pretty big thing to push on, so we should expect the acceleration to be fairly small, and that's what we're seeing here.
The next part is the velocity. Remember from a few slides back that change in velocity is acceleration times time. So we write that down and put in the acceleration we just calculated. That gives delta v equals 0.4 meters per second squared times 3 seconds. When we multiply the numbers together, we get 1.2. The seconds in the time cancels out one of the seconds in the acceleration, leaving us with 1.2 meters per second. Since this is a speed, the units are distance divided by time. Also, 1 meter per second is a slow walking pace, which sounds about right.
Now it's your turn to try one of these. If an asteroid hits Mars, how much does Mars accelerate? Also, how much will Mars' velocity change as a result of the impact?
Remember to do just what is needed for the calculation. You don't need all of these numbers for all parts of the calculation, so don't put in extras. Also, there is at least one piece of information you're going to have to look up to finish the calculation. Look at the units and make sure you have the right ones in there.
Remember this table? You should be using it to help you keep track of the equations we use in this course. Fill in the A equals F over M section of this table now. Keep it and update every time we use a new equation. You'll find this page useful doing homework and reviewing for exams. Depending on your section, you may be required to submit a copy of the completed version for credit. There are a couple more things to remember about the second law of motion. First, it applies to changes of direction, not just changes of speed. I won't have you calculate changes of direction, but you need to appreciate the idea because it's important for understanding orbits. If something is moving in a curved path, like a circle, then there is a force acting on it, even if it's always going at the same speed. In the case of the ball and the string, in this picture, the force comes from the string pulling the ball towards the center. If the string breaks, the force is removed, and the ball goes off in a straight line in whatever direction it was moving at that time.
The last thing to talk about with the second law is weight. What we call weight is really just the action of gravity on an object. So it's a force, and we use force units to describe it. Pounds are a force unit, not a mass. So pounds are more like newtons than like kilograms, since kilograms are mass units instead. So your weight is your mass in kilograms times the acceleration of gravity. On Earth, the acceleration is 9.8 meters per second squared. On other planets, the acceleration is different, though your mass in kilograms is the same. You should try calculating your weight in newtons this way. This will give you a better sense of what forces in newtons feel like. You'll also be able to better judge whether or not you're doing it right when you calculate your weight on other worlds using the law of universal gravity later on. You'll probably get a weight that is at least several hundred newtons and possibly over 1,000. If you're not sure what your mass in kilograms is, take your weight in pounds and divide it by 2.2.
Now it's time to move on to the third law of motion. This is sometimes called the action-reaction law. It says that whenever one body exerts a force on a second body, the second body exerts an equal and opposite force on the first.
For a more direct way of understanding the third law, just try hitting a wall, but not so hard that it does any damage to you or the wall. What you'll find is that while you exert a force on the wall, this doesn't have much effect. However, the wall exerts an equal and opposite force on your hand, and that part hurts. This shows the key idea in the third law of motion. This law deals with the forces between two bodies. It essentially says that when one body pushes on another, the second pushes just as hard on the first. Notice that this is different from the previous two laws of motion. Those just looked at the forces acting on one body. This law is the only one that relates forces between two different bodies.
Another example is the pitcher throwing a ball earlier in this slideshow. The pitcher was exerting a force on the ball, and as he was doing that, the ball was exerting an equal force on the pitcher. So why did the ball go flying and the pitcher didn't? Take a moment and see if you can figure out the answer for yourself. Have you got it? Think back to the second law. Acceleration is force divided by mass. The ball and the pitcher both feel the same force, but their masses are very different, so the acceleration is very different. The ball has a small mass, so its acceleration is large. Well, the pitcher has a large mass, so his acceleration is small.
A rocket is a nice example of Newton's third law of motion. A rocket works by heating up gas and forcing it out a nozzle at high speed. Since the rocket is pushing on the gas is also pushing on the rocket, according to Newton's third law of motion. It's this push from the rocket's gas that accelerates it forward. It's not pushing off the ground, it's pushing off its own exhaust.
In principle, you could do the same thing. Just stand on a skateboard and hold a bucket of rocks. If you start throwing rocks in one direction, you should start moving in the opposite direction, and that would make you a rocket. If you try this, don't do it any place where people are likely to be hit by the rocks. If rocks aren't an option for you, imagine standing on a skateboard, spraying hairspray in the other direction. Would that work? Now that we've gone through Newton's laws of motion, you should be able to fill in this table. This will help you know which laws apply to which situations. Try filling this in before you do the next your turn. We've already given a few astronomy examples, but you should leave room in that last column to add more examples as we learn about them later in the course.
Now it's time to see if you can apply Newton's laws. We're going to look at the case of riding an elevator. The elevator starts out speeding up to 2 meters per second. Then it goes at a constant speed afterwards. Notice that Part B deals with the time when it is speeding up, while Part C deals with the time when it's going at a constant speed. Remember to apply Newton's laws to answer these questions. This question gives you practice thinking about the world in terms of forces and accelerations. You should try this more generally. Try looking at things around you and figuring out what forces are acting on them. And do those forces balance out, or do they cause accelerations?